Revelation chapter 15, easy to find back of the Bible, chapter 15, and we'll look at verse 1. And I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, seven angels who had seven plagues, which are the what? Last. Because in them the wrath of God is finished. So these seven last plagues that we're going to see are the wrath of God poured out upon the world. This is like the fullness of his wrath. Now, we're not talking about, you know, eternal hell here, but we're talking about God's wrath poured out upon the world. These plagues also mirror, I think as we already seen, we did, mirror the 10 plagues that God poured out on Egypt. So let's look at Revelation chapter 16. We'll start with verse 2. So here's the first plague. If you want to write notes, I didn't put the PowerPoint up. I didn't make one up for you. I should have. But you can write notes. First plague, verse 2, and it's excruciating pain. So the first angel, I'll read it while you're writing. So the first angel went and poured out his bowl on the earth. And it became a loathsome and malignant sore on the people who had the mark of the beast and who worshipped his image. And so this excruciating pain as they have these sores covering their bodies, the first plague. The second plague, dead man's blood. Dead man's blood. Verse 3. It sounds like a movie title, doesn't it? That'd be a great Dead Man's Blood. What a great movie. Verse 3. The second angel poured out his bowl into the sea, and it became blood like that of a what? Dead man. And every living thing in the sea died. Now, it wasn't literally a man's blood, but it was like a dead man's blood. So that's plague number two. Third plague, water and blood. Third plague, water and blood. Verse 4 and onward. Then the third angel poured out his bowl into the rivers and the springs of waters, and they became blood. So the springs, the flowing water, it becomes blood. And I heard the angel of the water saying, and he praises the Lord for what God is doing. He says, you're righteous in doing this. Verse 6, you're avenging the blood of the saints. And says, these people receiving the plagues deserve it, the end of verse 6. And then you hear the saints who were martyred during the tribulation saying, amen. Yes, O Lord, the Almighty, true and righteous are your judgments. So thus far, help me out, we're going to just review so we're not feeling like we're behind. The first plague is the plague of excruciating pain. You got it? That's the source. Excruciating pain. The second plague found there in verse 3, we say is what? Dead man's blood. Now the third plague, verse 4, is water and blood. That's great. You guys are awesome. Those of you at home, you should be writing this stuff down. Try not to multitask, okay? And then the fourth plague is sun and thirst and blasphemy, which is a terrible word to try to spell. Blood and thirst and blasphemy, B-L-A-S-P-H-E-M-Y, just whatever you want to put, blasphemy, however you want to spell it. That means speaking out against God in a profane way. Verse 8 is the fourth plague. Sun and thirst and blasphemy. The fourth angel poured out his bowl upon the earth, sun, and it was given to scorch men with fire. Men were scorched with fierce heat, and they blasphemed the name of God who has the power over these plagues. And they did not repent so as to give him glory. So sun, thirst, blasphemy. The fifth plague, simply darkness. Verse 10. Then the fifth angel poured out his bowl on the earth and and the fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and his kingdom became darkened. And they gnawed their tongues because of pain. So they're in pain, and now they can't see anything at all. This is a palpable darkness. It's a darkness that can be felt. And we've said that, you know, the outer darkness that Jesus says represents hell will be something like this. It'll be a darkness that isn't just lights off darkness, but it's a spiritual darkness. It's a darkness that is thick. We can't understand it unless you were an Egyptian in the land of Egypt when this thick darkness came upon Egypt, or if you were to be in the Great Tribulation time. We've never experienced anything like this. The fifth angel, and they gnawed their tongues because of pain. And look at verse 11 again. It says, and they what? Blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores and did not repent of their deeds. Now, the sixth plague is spiritual warfare. Actually, it's two-pronged, but it's spiritual warfare to begin with. Look at verse 12 and verse 14. The sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river, the Euphrates, and its water was dried up so that the way would be prepared for the kings from the east. Verse 14, for they are spirits of demons. So, you know, the battle of Armageddon isn't just a flesh and blood battle. You know what I'm saying? It's not just soldiers fighting and tanks and Air Force support. It's actually a spiritual battle, isn't it, you guys? Behind this whole thing is Satan wanting to rule the world, destroy God's people. And so this is a real spiritual battle. It also involves the sixth plague, not only spiritual warfare, but nakedness and shame. Look at the 15th verse. Jesus warns, Jesus is encouraging we believers who are reading this by saying, behold, I'm coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake and keeps his clothes so that he will not walk about naked and men will not see his shame. Does anybody remember that story of the king's new clothes? Do you all know that story? I think it's just hilarious. It's a classic. And if you don't think your kids know it, make sure you tell your kids, your grandkids, or, you know, relatives. So here's the king, and he's completely so narcissistic that, you know, he is convinced that he is wearing these wonderful clothes that no one else can have, and everybody else is going along with it, but he's really naked. And spiritually, that can be a problem with people. Spiritually, they look great, they think, but they're really spiritually, they're naked. You know, they're not clothed in righteousness in terms of their walk with Christ. And so there's a nakedness and shame that is given as a warning here, and I just thought it would be something that we should add. So the sixth plague, spiritual warfare, nakedness, and shame. And then the seventh plague, which would be the last, is earthquake. Earthquake. I was just reviewing pictures again of the very serious earthquake that occurred just a few months ago in North Central California, where, you know, in Napa and Santa Rosa and those areas where they had the earthquake was extremely severe. And it was the strongest in 30 years, 25 or 30 years, they say. And this will be an earthquake that will be like nothing the earth has ever experienced before. Verse 18 says, there were flashes of lightning and sounds and peals of thunder, and there was a great earthquake, such as there has not been since man came to be upon the earth. So great an earthquake it was, and so mighty. In addition to this, an angel declares at the end of the outpouring of the wrath of God, the angel declares in verse 17 that it is done. And then there's this earthquake. So this is the fullness of the wrath of God poured out upon the world. So here's a summary of the seven last plagues. Excruciating pain. You follow? Dead man's blood. Help me out. I'm okay with your help. Go ahead. Water and blood, scorching sun and thirst, what? Darkness, huh? Well, spiritual warfare and a great earthquake. Maybe you're reading from the New Living Translation notes. Okay. Now, I want us to look at something that is mentioned. Hold your place here. Hold your place. Don't lose it. But let's go to the left to the book of Romans. We're going to Romans, and we're going to look at chapter 5, which is one of my most favorite books, chapters in the Bible. It might be yours as well because of what it tells us about what Jesus has done for us. And so here in Romans chapter 5, it says, verse 6, let's start with verse 6. For while we were still helpless, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. That is, we're helpless. There is nothing we could do to get ourselves into heaven. There still is nothing we can do to get ourselves into heaven, right? Okay. If we could have a pageant and see who is the best person here, and, you know, we could all vote some people off the island, vote them off, you know, out of heaven. I don't know what we'd do. And you, that one person, they get up here, and they're like the most righteous, good, godly person in the entire church. They would still be helpless to stand before God or to get into heaven. You understand that. Nobody is more helpless than anyone else. We are all, tell me, helpless. I'm not more than you. You're not more than me. It's level. When you're helpless, you're just helpless, right? So while we were still helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. There was an appointed time. There was an appointed place. And Jesus, at that very right time, as God the Father had predicted and determined, Jesus died for the ungodly. See that? Ungodly. What's the opposite of ungodly? Yeah, godly. So Jesus didn't die for godly people because there aren't any to die for. He only died for the ungodly. That's all there were to die for. And then Paul gives a for instance. For one would hardly die for a righteous man. Though perhaps for the good man, somebody would dare even to die. You know, it's not natural for people to want to, you know, take a bullet for somebody else. But he says, okay, maybe somebody would take the execution for someone else, for a really good person. Maybe that could happen. But look at verse 8. God says, Paul says, but God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God didn't just die for the, well, maybe that one good person, you know, quote unquote good, that somebody might die for. No, God showed his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So again, here is helpless, ungodly sinner. Say that. Helpless, ungodly sinner. When Jesus saved me, I was a helpless, ungodly sinner. You don't sing about that too much, do we? But that's just the truth. Wow. That's amazing. I mean, yeah, we're confessing I was helpless. I was ungodly, and I was a sinner, and yet Jesus died for me despite that. Look at verse 9, much more than. The Greek terms here, these are big, big terms. It's like not just more now or much beyond, but much more than. Having now been justified by his blood. To be justified means that God looks at me just as if I'd never sinned. So now, having been justified by his blood, Jesus' blood, we shall be saved from the what, gang? Wrath of God through him. So let's read verse 9, all of us together. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
We're saved from the wrath of God. Tell me what the wrath of God is. Tell me in our context that we've been studying right now in the book of Revelation, what is the wrath of God? Tell me. Seven last plagues. You're right on. The seven last plagues, the wrath of God poured out, Revelation 15, verse 1. We will be saved from the what? Wrath of God. Again, let's hear it. Amen. The Bible says that we were by nature children of wrath. I mean, we were born to be destined for wrath, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 3 says. We were born in such a way that we were just wrath-deserving, helpless, ungodly sinners. But the Bible says that Jesus experienced the punishment of God's wrath for us. Jesus' sufferings, I want you to go back now. I want you to go back to Revelation chapter 16. And we know generally, most of us know about what happened to Jesus on the way to the cross and at the cross and on the cross. We shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. The Bible says that Jesus experienced the punishment of God's wrath for us. Jesus' sufferings, and this is something that I think is phenomenal. This is something that I don't know, I didn't get it from anybody. I never heard it before from anybody. But I see how Jesus experienced every bit of the wrath of God. All seven plagues, which represent all the wrath of God, hello, right? Jesus experienced all of it because somebody had to take the wrath we deserve. I mean, frankly, we all deserve to experience all of this, but Jesus saved us from it. I mean, Jesus' sufferings correspond to the seven last plagues. First of all, the first plague is what? You go back to your notes, it's what? Excruciating pain. Do you know that crucifixion is one of the most terrible, brutal ways to die? Do you see this? Do you see this? I don't know how well you can. I wish, you know, there was a way for all of us to hold one, because this is what you want to do. You know, the nails were here. The nails were here. This, put your finger right here and kind of push it in just a little. That's very sensitive. And there's a nerve running through here that if it gets pierced, you cannot imagine the pain that you would. And the Romans, so barbaric. You know, they were so cultured, and yet at the same time, to crucify people. And so this nail would go through the wrist and would hold the crucifixion victims to the cross. And then their feet would be put on top of each other, and one nail would go through their feet. Brutal. The agony is impossible to explain. I have read doctors' accounts of what a person who's being crucified would go through, and it is just unbelievably brutal, and the pain would be excruciating. So the first plague Jesus experienced for us is excruciating pain. The second plague is what? Blood. His blood was shed. He had that bloody scourging. They would take a cat of nine tails. They would take, you know, they'd have leather with a handle, and they would put pieces of glass tied to the edges of these leather strips or pieces of metal, and they would throw it at the back of the victim that was being scourged, it was called. And then it would stick, think like barbs sticking in your back, and then they'd rake it down. And it would just shred the back of the victim. I saw one of the stones that they used in the place where Jesus was scourged in Jerusalem. I've never seen this before. But you see this big round rock, and how they would pull you over and they would tie your hands over, and you could see you would just be, you'd be basically like this, and just your back fully bared. They'd rip your back. And so you think when Jesus was walking to the cross, he had his back was torn down. And they put that robe on him, and then they ripped it off. Oh. A bloody death. But then third, it's, tell me what the third plague was, gang. Blood mixed with water. In John 19:34, we're told, but one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and what? Water came out. The fourth plague is scourging, is scorching sun and thirst and blasphemy. On the cross, Jesus said, I am what? Thirsty. He experienced that plague of you know, having a thirst. And it wasn't just, he was experiencing the thirst that comes from the wrath of God. While he was on the cross, his enemies blasphemed. Do you remember that? And it says, and over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, this is the Jesus, the King of the Jews. That was to be a placard mocking his claim. Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. That was to further insult Jesus. He's numbered among criminals, you see. And those who passed by and derided him, wagging their heads and saying, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you're the Son of God, come down from the cross. So also the chief priests and the scribes and the elders mocked him, saying, oh, he saved others. He can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we'll believe in him. And they get all the people laughing with him. He trusts in God. Let him deliver him now, for if he desires him. For he said, I'm the Son of God. And the robbers who were crucified with him also reviled him in the same way. Blaspheme. The Son of God is a blaspheme. Fifth plague is thick darkness. Jesus experienced that. Luke says it was now about the sixth hour, and darkness fell over the whole land until the ninth hour, because the sun was obscured. This thick darkness. When God's judgment comes, there's this hellish darkness. God wrapped a blanket of night around the land, as he did when he sent a plague of darkness upon Egypt during the time of Moses. Many skeptics have claimed that the darkness mentioned here is just a myth, yet they have a problem. Listen to this. There are ancient secular historians who support what the Bible says. They record that this frightening darkness not only came over Israel, but extended as far as Italy and Egypt. I've read research and an account of it appearing in the archives of Rome. Tertullian, one of the church fathers, writes, frightened people stopped eating their noontime meal. Travelers wouldn't go on, or possibly couldn't go on, until the darkness passed. Dionysius, who observed this ominous darkness in Heliopolis, Egypt, exclaimed, either God himself is suffering, or he is mourning over the sad condition of a great sufferer, or the world is coming to an end. That's what a pagan said. You see, the whole pagan world was experiencing this darkness too. As darkness came upon the world, and then the sixth plague is spiritual warfare, nakedness and shame. Needless to say, the spiritual warfare before, during the cross, Jesus in the garden, struggling. Spiritual warfare, I was thinking, demon, where's the demon in all this, you know, the army of Armageddon, the armies of demons, and spiritual battle there, and in the sixth plague, and then it's like, oh, I forgot. During supper, the devil, having already put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, to betray him. Satan was there, wasn't he? Right at the communion table. And there he left, and the spiritual battle became more and more intense. as hellish legions. The Bible doesn't say this. This is what I personally could see. Hellish legions just pushing Jesus to the cross. Can you imagine the mass of hell just seeing the Savior, you know, the Messiah, you know, they're pushing him to death. They're pushing him to the cross. They're watching him being manhandled and tortured and come within, you know, just moments of his death and then crucified and the nails go through. And if they could, they would help drive the nails. The nakedness and shame. They hung victims of crucifixion without their clothes on in order to multiply not just the pain of the death, which is indescribable, but the shame on top of it. People poking fun, people saying the snide remarks. Jesus hung naked on a cross. But Hebrews 12, verse 2 says, he endured the cross, despising its shame, disregarding its shame. Amen? And then 7, the last plague, involved a proclamation and a great earthquake. As Jesus fulfilled the last of the wrath of God, he cried out, what? It is finished. What did the seventh plague say? It is done. Do you see the parallels here? Is this crazy or what? Say it's crazy. It's crazy. And then there was, after he said, is the finished, then Matthew says, now there was a great earthquake that occurred. So Jesus cries out, it is finished, the great earthquake, and I just got to look at it one more time. I got to review this. First of all, excruciating pain, then blood mixed with water, then scorching sun and thirst and blasphemy, then thick darkness, then spiritual warfare, nakedness and shame, then a proclamation and a great earthquake. You see, Jesus took all the wrath of God upon himself. He took the full wrath of God that we deserve. And now, you know, I understand 1 Thessalonians 1:10 a lot more because it says Jesus is the one who rescues us, delivers us from the wrath to come. Amen? Jesus rescued us from the wrath to come. See, God just couldn't say, well, I'm just not going to. Somebody had to take it for us. For a good one, somebody might die, but God has shown his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. 1 Thessalonians 5:9 says, for God has not destined us for wrath, amen, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He took Revelation 16:4 us. Who would think you'd see the crucifixion in Revelation 16? I mean, but it's right there, is it? It's theologically, it's there. Jesus won the battle. Write down Colossians 2:15. Jesus won the battle. Okay, I don't know if I can do this. Satan and his hosts, you know, they're, yeah, crucify him. And then Jesus wins the battle, because what's going to happen on the third day? Rise from the dead. And I love what it says in Colossians 2:15. He disarmed the spiritual rulers and authorities. He shamed them publicly by his victory over them on the cross. It's crazy. You know, Satan thought the cross, it defeats Jesus. And Jesus says, I'm going to take this cross. And now it's his sword. And he defeats the enemy through what the enemy thought was the worst. Jesus says, and if I be lifted up from the earth, and it's talking about his cross. He was talking about when he would be crucified. If I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men to me. Peter writes, for Christ also died for sins once for all, and the just for the unjust, so that he might bring us to God. Christ suffered once for all our sins. It's never going to happen again, doesn't need to happen again, because what he did on the cross for us is enough. He could say, it is finished. P Paid in full is what that word meant. It doesn't mean so much something is done as it's something's paid for is what that means. All the debt that we owed to God, all the debt that we could never pay, Jesus took on the cross. And he, because he's so awesomely righteous and perfect and God in the flesh, his life was so infinitely worthy that he had the value, the worth to pay off all the sins of the world for the billions and billions and billions and billions of people who would ever live. That's what Christ definitely did. He suffered because of other sins, the righteous one for the unrighteous ones. He went through it all, was put to death, then made alive to bring us to God. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we are just so grateful that you took the wrath of God for us. We would say, Father in heaven, thank you for sending your Son for us to take the wrath that you will pour out on this world for us. We are amazed as we witness your sufferings, as you show them through your word. I think the greatest amazement is that you would do it for us helpless, ungodly sinners. We thank you that you've made us righteous, you've covered us with your life, and in your eyes, we are perfect before the Father. Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for what you've done for us.